Okay, so welcome to today's class. Today we are going to discuss distance measures. Let us first see, first discuss one of the distance measure that we all are familiar with from our school days. I'm sure everybody knows what we mean by Euclidean distance, right? This is Euclidean distance is used to compute the distance between any two given points, and normally we use this distance measure for measuring the points which are in 2D space, right? So for example, here, you know, the example that you see here, here one point has coordinate x1 comma y1, another coordinate has x2 comma y2, and then using the Euclidean distance formula, we calculate the distance d. Okay, to write these coordinates, which are x1, y1, and x2, y2, we can use another representation, which is kind of a vector. So we can say x1, y1 is represented here now in terms of a two-dimensional vector where there are two rows and one column. Right? There's no difference between writing this x1, comma y1 here and x1, y1 here like this. There's just a different representation. Because I mean, this representation we will be following when we define other distance measures. So that is why I'm just introducing that here. So in one way we can say that we are computing the distance here, Euclidean distance between these two points, x1 comma y1 and x2 comma y2, and we are getting this value d. Or in another way, we can say that we are comparing two vectors of two-dimensional vector, this one and this one, and we are getting the distance between these two points. Okay. Now the question comes like, why do we need to study distance measures in this particular course? So just to have a little background. So one of the tasks that we do in computer vision is the object recognition, right? What do we do in object recognition? In object recognition, there's some object given, or there's some object which we already know in our memory. And whenever we see a new object from our memory, we try to recall what that particular object is, right? For example, in this case, let's say you are doing face recognition. So you know this person already. So this is in your memory. And when you say training sample or training, basically means that this information you know, right? Or if you are talking about the computer vision or about the computers, then that basically means that computer knows the information about this person, right? It has already learned it. Now, when a new sample comes, for example, this image, now we have to find out whether this particular sample belongs to this person or not, okay? Or you can say another sample of the same person, you have to just check whether this particular sample belongs to this person or not, and so on. So now, when we have to compare the two given faces in this case, or in general, any images of any given two objects, in that case, one way to compare them is based on pixel-wise comparison. You take one pixel from here, take another pixel as the same location here, and then we see if they are really same or not. Okay, that is one way. So if suppose this is 10 cross 10 image, and these are also 10 cross 10 images, then basically you will be matching those 100 values, and then you will try to find out whether they are actually same values or they are not same values, right? But the problem here in this particular kind of matching is that if you just see this example, for us it is very simple to say that these all images are actually belonging to the same person. But if you compare this image and this image here, you find that in this particular part there is no illumination, or not much illumination, we should say. But in this particular part here in this object, there are a lot of illumination. So if you just match directly these images by comparing the pixel values, I am sure, it's easy to understand that these images will not match. Okay. So normally, whenever we do object recognition, or whenever we do, this particular example where we are doing face recognition, we don't directly match the object pixels. But what we do, we first extract some unique information from the image, and then we try to match that information. Okay, and we assume that whatever information you are extracting from the images of the objects, that information is invariant to the problem that you see here. For example, because of the illumination, you see the pixel have different different properties. Sometimes you may find that this image is one image, I mean training image is small, but the test image is bigger. There's a problem of scale. Sometimes you might find some rotational problems. So to overcome these problems, we normally don't directly match the images, but we extract some features out of those images, and then we try to do the recognition based on that those features. So we can consider this example of face recognition, where we can just think of these simple features which we extract from the faces. For example, one of the feature we can take is the distance between the eyes. So between the two eyes, whatever the distance you have, that can be one feature. Similarly, what is the width of the nose? That can be another feature. Length of the jawline, the green line that you see here, that can be another feature. Structure of the cheekbone, depth of the eye sockets. So these are the features you can consider from any face image. Now, if you just go through these features, you find that these features are up to quite extent invariant to many of the problems that we discuss. Like, for example, we consider the illumination problem. Now, in this case, though these pictures are different in terms of illumination, but if you just consider the distance between the eyes or the width of the nose or length of the jawline, they will be similar. They are not actually going to be different because of just illumination has got changed. Okay. So whenever we do object recognition, or particularly like this in this example, when we do face recognition, we don't directly match the images. We take out some features from those images and then do the recognition. So in this example, so suppose you have to match this this face with this face. So here, let's say from face one, you have extracted these features, X1, X2, X3, X4, X5. And from this second picture, you have extracted the features Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4, and Y5. Now the question comes, when you have these two feature sets or these two feature vectors, how will you find out whether they are same or not? Whether these images are same or not, or that in other way you can say, if these images are going to be same, if this feature vector and this feature vector is going to be same. So now the question comes, how to find out whether these two feature vectors are same or they are not same, right? So the obvious answer is to find out the distance between them. So that is why we are going to study the distance or distance various distance measures in this particular class. And this motivation we have we have discussed based on one of the application, which is object recognition. But in general, there are many other applications in computer vision where distance measures will be used. Okay. Now the distance between the difference between the measures that we are going to discuss here and what we know from our school days is that in school days we have always studied between the distance between only two dimensional vectors, or sometimes maybe three dimensional vectors, but we have not gone beyond that. Right, our vector will be either, it will have two coordinates, or it will have at the max three coordinates, and we have computed the distance between those feature vectors. But in this case, our vectors are going to be longer than that. Like sometimes we find that the feature vector that we are going to discuss, they are even have distance, dimension 100 or maybe 200 and so on. So in general, we can say whatever feature vectors that we are going to compare here, they will have k dimensions. Right? That means the k feature values you will have in those feature vectors. And then we'll try to find out the distance between those k dimensional feature vector to find out whether the two feature vectors are same or they are different. Okay. So when we do the object recognition, as I just said, that whatever object we are going to recognize, that object some way we have already learnt it in our memory, or if you are going to recognize it with the help of computer, that means computer has already learned about that object. So when computer is doing object recognition, or when we are doing object recognition, we don't just know only one object, we know several objects, right? So we can say that our memory is, or the computer's memory is, collection of the learning obtained from various objects, right? So in general, we can say that in our computer, we have n different objects stored in the memory, or the other way you can say that computer has learned about n different subjects. And in terms of representation, you can say that the feature vectors obtained from those n objects, they are arranged in the form of a matrix, where a particular column tells you about the information of one object, right? Or the feature extracted from the one object. Similarly, for the other object, you have another feature vector here. For the third object, you have another feature vector here. And one thing you can notice here is that every feature vector is represented in terms of k values. That means from every object, we are extracting k different features, and then we are putting those features here together in columns. And when we collect all these columns, it becomes a matrix of size k cross n, where k is the dimension of every feature vector, and you have n different objects. Okay. Now, when a new object comes and you want to recognize that object with and try to find out what that particular object represents, that you can say, let's say that is available in terms of a test sample. So one object has come as a test sample, let's say O, and from that object you have extracted these features. So now if you have to find out what this particular object is, you have to take this object and match it to all the available objects in your memory, right? All the objects, let's say you have n objects here, you will take this sample and you will match it to all the samples, all the feature vectors available here in the memory. And wherever you find that this object has the least distance, that can be considered as the highest matching feature vector, and corresponding to that feature vector, you can say, you can name that particular object, right? For example, in this case, let's say this O object has the least distance with respect to this feature, this feature vector, then we can say that this object O is nothing but it is object O3, all right? Right. So in this example also, we are seeing that we are basically comparing k dimensional vector to find out or to do the object recognition. This was a k dimensional feature vector, and this k dimensional feature vector has been compared one by one with all these vectors that are available here, and based on the distance we have decided the label for this new object. Okay. Now let us go into the details of the distance measures that we are going to discuss. In this slide, you see three different types of distance measures. One is the Euclidean distance, which we all know. Another is the city block distance. It is also sometimes called Manhattan distance. And the third is the chessboard distance, which is sometimes called the max distance, right? And all these formulas are actually given here for the two-dimensional space, but we'll see a generic formula in the next slide. And with the help of that, you can very easily extend all these formulas that you see here for 2D. You can extend them to 3D. Okay. Now let us go one by one to these definitions. So I guess everybody knows how do we define the Euclidean distance. We have given two points x and y. Two points P and Q. P has the coordinate x and y, and Q has the coordinate s and t. And to compute the distance between P and Q, you have to just say x minus. You have to take the difference of x and s and then whole square, and difference of y and t and whole square. You have to add that, and then you have to take the square root, and that gives you the distance, Euclidean distance between these two points. Now, to compute the city block distance or the Manhattan distance, what we are doing here, if we just compare with the previous example, we are computing the difference between x and s. We also compute the difference between x and s here also, but here you have raised it to power 2, but here you're not raising the power. Similarly, y and t, you are computing the difference between y and t, but you are not putting the power. What you are doing here, in some sense, you can say just you are subtracting these values, or from the two points that you have, p and q, the corresponding coordinates are subtracted, or there, the difference between them is computed, and then just you are adding them to find out the distance. All right. Similarly, in the chessboard distance, you are again computing the difference between them, but here the distance is the maximum of all that values that you get by computing the differences, right? So for example, here in this case you have just two differences, so whatever maximum comes from here, that becomes the chessboard distance between those two points. But consider if this would have been a n dimensional case, then in this particular case, let's say the last case, chessboard distance, you will get n different values. So out of those n different values, whatever is the maximum, that will define the chessboard distance. Okay. Let's see the example in case of 2D. All these examples that you see here on the right side, they are for the 2D. When we define these distance measures for a general case, I mean, we can just extend these examples. Okay. So the example that I've given here is are for only city block distance and chessboard distance. And the reason is that, I mean, I've not given an example for the Euclidean distance, but because I assume that is a very common thing and all of us are very much familiar with this. Now, you might be thinking that what is the use of defining so many distance measures? So later, one by one, when our course proceeds, we'll see that these distance measures, if you compare them, in some sense, you may find that one is helping or one is better compared to other one in some certain scenarios, right? For example, if you just compare the Euclidean distance and city block distance, in these two examples, you'll find that if you just compare their values, Euclidean, the value of Euclidean distance and the value of city block distance for any given two points in 2D, you will find that those values will be very similar. I mean, very, very much close to each other. You'll not find much difference. Okay, maybe here, as you see from the formula, Euclidean distance will be giving you the exact value of the distance, and the city block distance will be giving you the some kind of approximation of the distance between those two points. Approximation in the sense that Euclidean you get the exact value, and in case of city block distance you get the approximate value as compared to Euclidean distance. So maybe in Euclidean distance, let's say you get 2.35. So in city block distance, it might be 2, right? Or something like that. So now the question comes, why do we prefer city block distance over the Euclidean distance? So in this, if you just compare their formulas, you will see that when you compute these values, D4 or the city block distance and the Euclidean distance, the time required to compute this value is very less as compared to this one. Or in other sense, you can say the computation required to compute this D4 or the city block distance is very less as compared to the time required for computing this DE or the Euclidean distance. Why? Because here you are just subtracting those values. You are computing the difference between the coordinates, in respective coordinates, and then you are just summing them. But what you are doing here, you're calculating this difference and then taking the square and then adding all those values and then again taking the square root, right? Or if it is n dimensional case, we'll see that this will not be one, the square root, it will be nth root. So when you compute the nth root, it is going to also involve floating point arithmetic, which is going to be costlier compared to integer arithmetic. In this case, normally we see that we only consider about the images where the coordinates are just integers. These values that you are going to get here, they all are integers. So you are just working in the integer domain. But if you are computing, even though the values are integer here, but when you are taking the square root, you have to go to the floating point domain and you have to perform the floating point arithmetic, right? So if you compare these two operations, you'll find that D4 is computationally quite cheap as compared to DE. Now, what we are losing when we are using D4 as compared to DE, as I just said, that the values are going to be very, very similar. So if your problem is not very, it does not require very strict matching, in that case, city block distance can be preferred over the Euclidean distance, because it also does the same task, more or less what Euclidean distance does, but its computational cost is very less. All right. So similarly, you might find places where one of the distance measure may be applicable. So for example, you are implementing distance measure in a device where you want to do faster computation, memory might be less, so maybe you can prefer the city block distance. Right? Okay. Now, in general, all these distance measures can be defined with the help of LP norm. This is the definition of the LP norm, where defining this with respect to two vectors of k dimension. First vector has the values x1, x2, x3, xk. The second vector has the values y1, y2, y3, and so on, yk. And you are taking the difference between the respective coordinates taking the power p, and then you are adding all those differences, and then you are taking the power 1 by p. Okay, that defines the LP norm. Now we can we see here that, and sometimes this norm is also called Minkowski norm or Minkowski distance. And we see that for different values of p, LP norm will actually define the distance measures that we discussed. So if just consider p is equal to 2, so we'll find that p equal to 2 makes this square here, and then this square root, so it becomes Euclidean distance. Okay, similarly, if you just make p equal to 1, it becomes Manhattan distance, not city block distance. Right? You can just put this value, the value of p in this formula, and then just check that it becomes Manhattan distance. Okay, similarly, if you just replace the value of p by infinity, you will see that this will be actually max distance. And you can just analyze that here. For example, so when you are computing the max, I mean, this is infinity, this p becomes infinity. Okay, let us just first consider this particular, this p, don't think about this 1 by p. So when you are saying that this p is infinity, what exactly we mean by that? We are putting a very, very large number as power to this difference. Right? So when you are putting a very large power to this difference, and obviously you are going to get many differences with power p. So let's say first difference is 1, other another difference is 2, another difference is, let's say, again 1, and another difference is, let's say, 10. Okay, let us assume that we are considering comparison of 2 4 dimensional vectors. So when you are taking the difference between the first in the first dimension, you are getting 1. In the second dimension, you are getting, let's say, again. Yeah, so this is, let us assume this is 2. Then again, you are getting 1 and then 10. Now, if you raise the power of this to a very large number and then sum that, the value that you are going to get here by doing this plus this plus this, this is going to be very close to what we get if we just make 10 to the power p. Okay, in other sense, what we are saying here is that whatever maximum difference you have, that will basically dominate in the summation. Okay, other will be very negligible. So when others are negligible and this becomes just, let's say, 10 to the power p, when you take its pth root, what you will get from here? Just 10, which is nothing but the maximum of the differences that you have considered here, right? Out of 1, 2, 1, and 10, the maximum is 10. And that only comes out as the output of this process when we raise or when we make p as infinity. All right, just think about it. I hope this is clear. In case if it is not clear, we can again discuss in the next class. So when we make p as infinity, it becomes a max distance, and then it is simple to think about the opposite case where p becomes minus infinity, and in that case we'll find that this can be considered as the min distance, where the value that you are going to get as a distance will be the minimum of all the differences that you are computing in respective dimensions. Okay, now let us define the metric distance. So all these distance measures that we have discussed, or any the other distance measures which are there, if they satisfy certain characteristics, then we say that a particular distance measure which satisfies these characteristics that we are going to define here, then we say that that particular distance measure is a metric distance, right? So for example, question can be asked like this, that whether Euclidean distance is a metric distance or not, or city block distance is a metric distance or not, or chessboard distance is a metric distance or not. So how to find out whether a given distance measure is a metric distance or not? We have to just check these properties, whether in that particular distance measure, when you are defining the difference between the two points, whether these characteristics are satisfied or not satisfied. If these characteristics, all of them are satisfied, then that distance measure can be termed as a metric distance. Otherwise, it is not a metric distance, right? Now, let us see what are these distance measures. I mean, what are these characteristics? So the first characteristic is non-negativity. That means if you are computing the distance between any two given points, the distance that you are going to get should be a positive distance. Okay. Second is the property of identity, which says that if you are computing the difference, the distance between P and Q, where P and Q are same, then the distance should be zero. That means if you are computing the distance of a given point to itself, then it should be zero. If that, if this holds, then we can say that the identity property is true. Similarly, the symmetry property says that if you're comparing the difference between or distance between P and Q, and if you just compute the distance between Q and P, and if they both are coming same, then it will be a, the distance measure will satisfy this symmetry property. Okay, and the last one is the triangular inequality, which says that if you are computing the distance between, I mean, let's say you have one point here, another point here, and another point here. So this triangular inequality says that if you are computing the distance between these two points here, this value should be less than whatever you are going to get from here plus here. Okay, this is the property of triangular inequality. So you make a, I mean, you have three points and you join them to a triangle. So in that triangle, this property basically says that the length of one side should be less than the sum of the lengths of the other two remaining sides. Okay. So if all these four characteristics are satisfied by any distance measure, then that distance measure can be termed as a metric distance. Okay. So we can just think about all the distance measures that we have discussed here. Euclidean distance, Manhattan distance, max distance, and min distance. In all these cases, you can just analyze whether these properties are satisfied or not. And you'll find that all of them are actually satisfied in all the measures that we have discussed. So you can say that all these distance measures that we have discussed, they are the metric distance. Okay, some of the cases we will find particularly that this property of symmetry and the triangular inequality, they don't hold. I mean, we see some examples in the subsequent slides. So in those cases, we'll say that that particular metric is not it. That particular distance measure is not a metric distance. Okay. In general, when we talk about the LP norm, if your value of P is from 1 to infinity, we see that this is going to be, going to define a metric distance. Okay, but if the value of P is less than 1, then this does not define the metric distance. Right, that we can understand with the help of this example, because when P becomes less than 1, the property of triangular inequality does not hold. So you can see in this example, suppose this point is 0, 0, this point is 0, 1, this is 0, 0, this is 0, 1, and this is 1, 1. If you compute the distance between 0, 1 and 0, 0, this distance is going to be 1. You can just apply that formula, you will find that this value is going to be 1. Similarly, this distance is also going to be 1. Okay, now if you keep the value of these coordinates 0, 0 and 1, 1 in that formula, you will find that this distance is going to be 2 to the power 1 by P. Now here, if P is less than 1, then this power will be actually greater than 1. So the value that you are going to get by computing 2 to the power 1 by P, this is going to be more than 2. Okay, so if this distance is going to be more than 2, which is nothing but the sum of this distance plus this distance. So in that case, we can say that the triangular inequality does not hold, right? Because the distance of, the length of this side of the triangle is actually more than what you get by summing this and this, right? If the triangular inequality has to hold, and then in that case, this length is to this length need to be less than what you are going to get by summing this value and this value, right? This value and this value, whatever you're going to get as a sum from these two values, that should be more than this value. And this actually does not hold here. That is why the triangular inequality does not hold when P is less than 1, So that is why it is not a metric distance. All right. Now let us define another new distance measure. It is called the normalized Euclidean distance. This is very similar to what we do in Euclidean distance, but only this normalization is different here. If you see the formula here, this formula is very similar to what we, not in fact similar, it is exactly same what we use in normal Euclidean distance. Okay, well, in place of, you can say that in place of using the coordinates xi and yi, the original coordinates, we are saying they are xi prime and yi prime, right? If you see the original definition of let us say the LP norm, we are saying that the coordinates are xi and yi. In this case, xi and yi. In this case, what we are considering? We are considering xi prime, yi prime. So you can say that xi prime and yi prime, they have been obtained from xi by doing some, let's say, some operations. Okay. Fine. So now let us first understand why do we need normalized Euclidean distance? Why? What is the problem if we just use a normal Euclidean distance? Okay. So now let's just take this example. Suppose there are two persons, P1 and P2, and you want to find out whether those two persons are same or not. Okay, and let us say very simple feature we are using from this property. In this example, to match the two persons, and it is based on their weights and let's say their heights. Okay. So let us say this person has height 4 feet, and this person has let's say weight 50. And similarly, let us say this person has height 5 feet. And has weight 50. Okay. Yeah, one more thing. Let me just tell you when we are matching the objects with respect to distances. As I said in this example, let us just go back to that example again. So in this example here, I said that this particular test sample will match to the particular object here where the distance is going to be the least. Okay. But sometimes when we compute the distance, we don't just rely on this least value. We also put a threshold on the distance. So normally we say that whatever distance you are going to get, if that distance is less than a particular threshold, then only it is assumed that those two objects match. Otherwise, we say that they do not match. Okay. So in this example, let's say this object O, when you are comparing with these objects, here you get distance, let's say 5. Here you get distance 6. Here you get distance 3. Here you get, let's say, distance 10. Now, based on least, you can say that the 3 is the least. So this object matches to 3. Okay. But let's say we put a strict condition and we say that if the distance is going to be less than 1, then only we will assume that the two objects match. So in that case, we can say that we are assuming that this threshold T is equal to 1. Okay, so if this least value is not going to define the matching, we are also going to put an extra condition on that, and that is based on the threshold. Okay, so normally in matching we'll use threshold. So wherever we get the least, if that least is less than the threshold, then only we assume that the matching has succeeded. Sometimes you may find there are multiple distances where the threshold is criteria is satisfied. In that case, we can say that actually there are multiple objects which are similar to this test sample. Okay, so in this example, suppose your threshold becomes 5. So then we can say that this object O is similar to object 1 as well as object 3, right? In this matching, you will find multiple matchings for the given object. Okay, so let us come back to this original example. So here, let's say when you are matching these two vectors 4,50 and 5,50, and here we find that if you compute the distance by using Euclidean distance, you will find the distance 1, correct? Because I mean, here the difference is going to be 0, here the difference is going to be 1. 1 raised to the power 2 is 1, and then if you take the square root, it becomes 1. So distance 1 is, let's say, I mean, practically you will see that distance 1 is very, very similar. I mean, it's considered very close to each other. I mean, the two vectors that we are going to match, they are going to be considered close to each other because this distance has just come 1, which is very less. Okay. But if you just compare, the features, it is very easy to say that this these features are telling that the features obtained from the person, the persons from where these features have been obtained, they are very different because the height is very different. One person is just 4 feet height, has 4 feet height, and another person has 5 feet height. So the height difference is huge. So by just analyzing these features, you can very easily say that they are these feature vectors are actually representing two different persons. But if you just take the Euclidean distance, you will find that Euclidean distance will come very less, and if you, I mean, your threshold will be mostly larger than this value. So in that case, you may get confused that these two features are actually, or these two feature sets, or these two feature vectors are actually telling about the same person, right? Now, why this problem is coming here? The problem is just coming because the range in which you are representing this feature is different from this feature, right? Like in feet, the values that are going to be there, they will be normally 3 feet, 4 feet, 5, 6, at the most 7, right? But in case of weight, no value is going to be less than, let's say if you are just measuring the weights of adults, no value is going to be less than, let's say 40 or 30, right? You will not find anybody who is less than 40. I mean, if you find anybody less than 40, it might be very, very rare where the person is malnourished. Right? Otherwise, everybody will have at least 40 weight. Okay. So here the values are going to range in terms of weight. In this case, the values are going to range from, let's say, 40 to 80. But the value here are going to range from, let's say, 4 to 7. Right. So the range is very, very different. So now a little difference here will dominate, right? The two persons, let's say they have weight difference 5, and in the height difference, let's say they have very little difference. Overall, you'll find that the difference will be too much. Though they might be actually, the parameters or the features that you have obtained, they might be from the same person. One you might have taken today, and another you might have taken, let's say, after 1 month. So there might be some difference in the weight, but height will be normally consistent, right? So if the two person, you are comparing the same person after 1 month, you'll find that the weight, since weight has got changed, your matching criteria will tell that they are actually not same, though their heights are exactly same. Okay, exactly same, or maybe little difference because of the measurement. So how to deal with this? How to handle this problem where whatever features you are accumulating in your feature vector, they do not lie in the same range. So the solution to this is, solution to this problem can be obtained by doing the normalization. Okay, so in case of normalized Euclidean distance, in place of directly consuming the measurements that you have obtained from the objects, we are going to first normalize them and then we are going to use them. Okay, now there might be various methods of normalizing the distances or the features that you are that you have measured. One of the criteria could be this that I have listed here. Okay, here what we are doing, we are computing for a particular dimension, let's say for ith dimension, we are computing the mean for that dimension. We are subtracting the mean to the values that we are getting as a measurement, and then dividing it by the variance in that particular dimension. Okay, so you can see in this example, so suppose this is your line which tells you the distribution of heights. This is 4, this is 5. This is 4 and 7. All the heights are actually varying between 4 and 7. But if you see the weight, you will find that they are varying from 40 to 80. Okay. Now this variance, I mean, we'll study details about it later. But this variance, you can say in some sense, it tells the range in which the values are distributed. So if the, let's say the range is high, you can say the variance is going to be high. If the range is less, the variance is going to be less. So here, wherever you have less variance, you are going to actually divide the value, divide this difference xi minus mu y by a low value. But wherever that this range is going to be high, you are going to divide by a high value. So in that sense, you can say that the high value So one more thing. So when this variance is going to be high, your numerator is also going to be high, because there the values that you are measuring, they are also in a high range, right? If let's say you are measuring height, height will vary between 4 to 7. So whatever the difference you are going to get by computing xi minus yi, xi minus mu i for height, that will be also distributed in a smaller range. And you are dividing that by a small value sigma. But in the other case, where the values are ranging from 40 to 80, this value xi minus mu i will be also will be distributed in a high range, or the difference will be more, and that you are dividing by a high value mu i. The difference is going to be more. So when your numerator is low, you are dividing it by low value. When your numerator is high, you are dividing by a high value. So in that sense, you can say you can maintain a balance between the different features which are ranging in different ranges. Okay, so this is one way of normalizing the values. There are several other ways. Maybe in some other classes we will discuss that. So let me just conclude this distance measure here, that in case of normalized Euclidean distance, you are computing the normalized value of the features and then you are using them. And in case of normal Euclidean distance, you are directly consuming them. Okay, and the case where the feature distribution or the range in which the features are going to be distributed that varies, in that case, Euclidean distance is not going to give you the correct measure. So that is why in that case, we should prefer for the normalized Euclidean distance. All right.